Looking for filters? Check your coffee maker. This is Filter Free Radio with Jacob Dean and Skeptical Scott. FilterFreeRadio.com. Get ready to suck down some grounds.
I'm convinced that if we are to get on the right side of the world revolution, we as a nation must undergo a radical revolution of value.
FilterFreeRadio.com.
We must rapidly begin to shift from a thing-oriented society to a person-oriented society. When machines and computers, profit motives, and property rights are considered more important than people, the giant triplets of racism, militarism, and economic exploitation are incapable of being conquered.
Filter Free Radio, live Monday and Wednesday from 7 to 9 p.m. Eastern.
The time has come for America to hear the truth. There comes the time when silence is betrayal. The hottest places in hell are reserved for those who, in a period of moral crisis, maintain their neutrality.
Make your voice heard. Call in to the Filter Free Radio comment line at 202-6979-FFR.
Our only hope today lies in our ability to recapture the revolutionary spirit and go out into a sometimes hostile world declaring eternal hostility to poverty, racism, and militarism.
And welcome to a very jam-packed Monday here at Filter Free Radio. It is November 26th, 4:01 p.m. here in Portland, Oregon on the West Coast, where I'm speaking to you from. It is 7:01 p.m. on the East Coast, where our super-duper awesome mass producer and all-around good, awesome co-host, Mr. Skeptical Scott, is in Washington, D.C.
Hello.
Scott.
Hello. Always, yeah, I'm here.
Always good to have you with us, bud. And we are going to get into one hell of a show today. This is a two-hour program that is going to be needed to be repeated at least as many times as you can withstand. First of all, why are we protesting Walmart? The number one question I've got in every single conversation I've had with anyone since Black Friday about Black Friday, when I try to explain what the heck is going on here, why are people protesting Walmart? We're going to get into what happened here locally at the protest that I went to in Portland at my local Walmart, and also the factory fire in Bangladesh that Walmart is distancing itself from immediately in a statement released today, where now numbers are up to 124 dead now in this fire. Basically, yes, one of the reasons we are protesting Walmart is today, Walmart is one of the reasons we're still having things like the Triangle Factory Fire Massacre. Yes, one just happened Saturday evening in Bangladesh. We'll tell you more about that in a couple of minutes. We'll get into why the climate is probably the climate change deal and global warming and carbon emissions and the warming of the planet and kind of just climate change in general is the number one, you know, kind of thing to get behind right now. We're going to play some stuff from Bill McKibben, which I've been holding on to for a couple of weeks so we can piece it all together here. And we're going to get into that in the second hour of this program. Really, really good stuff to get into. I've had a few conversations with some folks and some friends since Black Friday. Excuse me. And one of the things that I've been trying to, you know, tell people about is, hey, there are some protests going on. Did you go to them? Did you know about them? Would you participate in them? Had you have known about them? These kinds of things. And the number one question that I get from everyone is, why are people protesting? Why? You know, and that's a really reasonable and probably most simple answer or question, rather, to ask. Is that's the easiest question to ask. Why are people protesting? And that's probably the best question to ask. And the problem is first of all, people's attention spans these days are so short that everyone needs simplified answers. people need these simple answers to these complicated problems that just don't exist. You can't explain why folks are really out in front of the Walmarts across the nation on Black Friday protesting. You can do a pretty darn good job if you say globalism or workers' rights or a living wage or these kinds of things. But really, the big picture is, and this is to steal a line from one of our Scott and I's favorite bands, Dawes, it really is a little bit of everything, what the folks are protesting here. It's been bugging me over the last couple of days, this question of why are people protesting? Because that is literally the question I've gotten from every single person I've engaged in this discussion since Black Friday. And I want to tell people that, first of all, your attention span is too short. So the answer that I need to give you won't fit in your attention span, period. You want a simple solution. You want a one-sentence soundbite. You want a magic bullet. It doesn't exist because this is a very complicated problem. To steal a line from this band Dawes, you could really answer why people are protesting Walmart, because it's a little bit of everything. It's globalization. It is capitalism. It is workers' rights. It is a living wage. It is equality, not inequality. It is the economics of shopping at Walmart versus shopping locally at a local owned business. And Scott and I have gotten into that quite extensively in the last couple of programs, that topic. It really is a little bit of everything. So I want to just kind of throw that on the table for folks who are asking, well, why are we protesting Walmart? Why should I care about protesting Walmart? You should care, because we're really all in this together. Scott, your initial thoughts before I play some really cool videos and stuff, and I want to get to this. Well, actually, real quick, no, I want to mention this in the opening conversation real quick as well. There is a garment factory in the capital of Bangladesh on Saturday evening where a fire happened in this factory. Some initial reports are saying 112 people are dead. Other numbers are saying 124 are now confirmed dead. But here's the kicker. This garment factory, this 8-story factory, had no emergency exits. What's your point? Well, this is also part of the reason why we should be boycotting and protesting Walmart, because these workers died in this Bangladesh factory while making clothes for Walmart. All those super awesome cool deals that you ran out to buy on Black Friday that were made in China or made in Bangladesh. Right. So in this stunning, like, cultural juxtaposition here, Black Friday merchants, the people at Walmart, we're going to get to a couple of clips from Fox interview with the VP of Walmart Communications, basically their vice president of bullshit propaganda spin machine. And these people are counting their profits and really kind of pumping up their shoppers on this, you know, Black Friday victory celebration kind of thing here. And it's all about buy, 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 sell, 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 merchandising, merchandising. And they're, like, celebrating all over, you know, through malls and ads and TVs, all sorts of things. Meanwhile, these factory workers on the other side of the world who made these products that these assholes are pushing, these people who worked in these factories in foreign countries, because, oh, by the way, we've outsourced all of our manufacturing work in this country overseas. That's a different conversation. But all of these people who made this clothing, these items that shoppers bought this last weekend, these workers were jumping out of windows, excuse me, out of a 7-story factory. I said 8-story. This was a 7-story factory. These folks were jumping out of the windows in an effort to save their lives on Saturday evening because the factory was literally being engulfed in this inferno and there were no emergency exits. So what's the point here? Well, isn't this like the ultimate final outcome of your capitalism race to the bottom, your globalization race to the bottom? And you know, Scott, chime in here, man.
Well, I thought you were going to play some clips, dude.
Well, yeah, well, I mean, I'm going to get to that in just a second, but I really want to talk about this factory fire first before we get to the Walmart protests here, and we'll tie it all in. But
well, it's endemic of where we are. I mean, economically, anyway, it's you know, it's not so much that we don't need these items. I mean, they make. I'm not sure if this was a clothing factory or what, but the bottom line is that we don't make anything here anymore, and why not? Because we've outsourced. So the big thing to remember and the takeaway from all this, if you get nothing out of this horrific disaster and tragedy, is that we still have sweatshops. We still have slavery. We still have all the things that we fought to get rid of and you know, during the Industrial Revolution and, you know, in the Depression era. And where are they? They're offshore. They're over in our penal colonies in Bangladesh and China and Thailand and you name it. And they're in places where there's no safety, there's no regulations, there's no oversight, there's no governmental oversight, where they pay slave wages. These people were locked in and they die in this horrific disaster, all while just toiling away in the most horrible conditions in the first place.
Yep.
And so it's because companies are allowed to do this because, well, it starts with trade tariffs and on. But the bottom line is it's a race to the bottom. And we don't see these things. We just go and buy our cheap shit, and we don't know where it comes from, other than the label on the packaging or on the clothing.
On the product,
and by the way, those labels on the product were fought for by activists who said we want to know where our shit comes from, and so they said, oh, fine, we'll put a label on it. Bangladesh, bam, here you go. Not, you know, which, you know, is a good step in the right direction. However.
Yeah.
We just have no control over the conditions in Bangladesh, and it speaks to our trade policy. It speaks to the fact that these companies really just rove around the world in this global economy that we have, finding the cheapest, poorest labor and to do their bidding, and to maintain our debtor nation. You know, this is why we don't make anything here anymore. We borrow and then we buy crap made in sweatshops in Bangladesh. And then the money goes back to our, you know, our debtors, and it just it's part of the global economy. And I think it's important for us to remember that our manufacturing jobs are not coming back to the United States, and this is why, because companies are able to outsource jobs to these third world nations and where this kind of tragedy happens. And so we should all feel somewhat responsible when if any of us have any clothing that is made in Bangladesh or really anywhere outside the purview of the United States and what I would consider humane working conditions.
Yeah. I will admit that Thanksgiving evening, actually, when some of the Black Friday sales first began at some of the stores, you know, they just totally blow out the Black Friday thing, and now it's come shop on Thanksgiving evening, right? You know, more consumption.
Which is even
worse. More consumption. Okay, guilty. I was totally part of the problem because I went out to Target and bought a Nikon camera that was made in Indonesia. And that was like $150 off, and I totally felt guilty about that the whole time. So that the next day on Friday, I actually went to the local Walmart here and covered some of the protest, and we'll get to that in like 2 seconds. But just to put a final punctuation here on this garment factory in the capital of Bangladesh, in Dhaka, I believe is how you pronounce it, in Bangladesh's capital, this garment factory, this fire that raced through this whole factory, seven-story factory, killing, some are saying 112 up to 124 people. And again, those folks were trapped by these flames because this building lacked emergency exits, according to officials. The blaze that broke out Saturday night at the factory, this factory was operated just outside of Bangladesh's capital. And the factory was operated by Tazreen Fashions LTD, which is a subsidiary of the Tuba Group, which makes products for, wait for it, you guessed it, Walmart and other companies in the United States and Europe. What does Walmart do, you might ask? In a statement today, Walmart said that the Tazreen Fashions LTD factory was no longer authorized to produce merchandise for Walmart after this disastrous catastrophe happens, but before it, it was just absolutely fine, right? Sorry, I added that last part. In this statement, Walmart goes on to say, but doesn't that make you sick? I'm sorry, I want to read that again. Walmart said that the Tazreen Fashions LTD, this factory, today, they released this today, 2 days after the fire and everyone died, 2 days after that happened, that this factory is no longer really authorized to produce merchandise for us, and a supplier subcontracted work to it, and it's in direct violation of our policies. So
how about that? So they managed to maintain their sourcing of manufacturing without actually having their dirty little fingers on it because they went through a subsidiary or
subcontractor or whatever.
Yeah, it'd be like a third party contractor.
Right.
Oh, so we didn't have any control. A third party contractor. You know, it's just such a sham. And you know, I'm looking up here, and it says since 2006, more than 500 Bangladeshi workers have died in garment factory fires. That's according to the Clean Clothes Campaign, an anti-sweatshop advocacy group based in Amsterdam. And Bangladesh is the world's second largest garment exporter after China. Imagine that.
Walmart's statement released today about the factory fire goes on to say, quote, today we have terminated the relationship with that supplier, end quote, it goes on, quote, the fact that this occurred is extremely troubling to us, and we will continue to work across the apparel industry to improve fire safety education and training in Bangladesh. We're not going to buy you new factories.
Wow.
We're not going to buy you new factories that are safe with safety standards, so you can have emergency exits to escape in case of fires. But we'll train you, and there'll be some fire safety education and business as usual, sweep it under the rug.
Nothing says lip service, and we don't really give a shit like that statement. I mean,
thank you, that was
the most non-apology apology. You know, to not even acknowledge the poor working conditions, the slave wages, I mean, the fact, the historical, when we just said this is the 500 person, people, 500 people have died since 2006,
right?
We'll teach them some safety measures. Give me a freaking break,
right?
You know, 1911, by the way, was the Triangle Shirtwaist Factory fire in Manhattan.
Thank you. That's what I'm referring to. Yeah,
1911 Triangle Shirtwaist Factory fire, where 146 people died, 71 injured, and it was just, if you see pictures of the sweatshop that these women worked in, it was just unbelievable. And so it's no different today in Bangladesh.
Yeah, and when that happened, there was a big uproar, there was an organized movement, there was activism, and there was a fight for things like no child labor laws and the weekend and a 40-hour work week and these kinds of things. Workers' rights are under attack. What do we do? We got to fight back, right? So
absolutely. And that's not even our workers. I mean, our workers are just losing their jobs at this point. And I shouldn't say just, but in addition to losing their jobs, I mean, look who you have to compete with in this global economy. People in these kind of work.
Yeah.
And these kind of working conditions.
Yeah, right. Yeah. That's okay. You cut out there for just a second. Real quick, to kind of punctuate this and to segue into the next part of this conversation. I'll play it now. This is really funny. Kenny Pick, hosted Turn Up the Night Tuesday and Fridays here, did this little bit with Tom Schaefer, co-host there at Turn Up the Night. And they did this really kind of cool little bit that I want to share with you. They're parroting kind of a libertarian paradise of, like, Bangladesh, for example, where corporations can move to, and they don't have any rules, they don't have any regulations to follow, like Scott was just talking about. This is really funny. Just a snippet of Kenny Pick's comedy here.
Are you tired of your government taking away liberties and freedoms you can't quite name? Are your vague platitudes and third-hand anecdotal facts falling on deaf ears? Well, come secede, or Sec D with us in the Teabagger Utopia.
Glenn, Becky, 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 Stan, Stan.
I will personally come to your house and help you pack.
Your hard-earned money is yours to keep. There are no taxes in Glen.
Becky, stand, stand.
Of course, there are no roads, bridges, police, fire protection, no teachers, hospitals, libraries, garbage pickup, or sewage treatment in Glen.
Becky, stand, stand.
But hey, who cares about that big government nonsense? You'll feel like our founding fathers as you struggle against the elements, fending off wild animals and your fellow teabaggers when provisions run low and their survivalist training kicks in.
Get off my land!
Who needs government? It's overrated. Join us in Glen.
Becky, stand, stand.
We have freedoms with none of the responsibilities. You want to shoot your gun in any direction? Go ahead. Want to lock your wife and children in the basement? Nobody's asking questions.
Oh, God.
Remember, freedom isn't free, but with a small down payment, it can be yours for a song.
Above the fruited plain.
Glen. Becky, stand, stand.
Our future is in the past.
Sounds great, right? But who... who really gets to take advantage of those is the big multinational corporations like Walmart, the behemoths that make billions and trillions that really benefit from those kinds of decisions and those kinds of paradises where there is no rules and these kinds of things. Oh, by the way, meanwhile, all of the protesting and all these things going on outside of the Walmarts during Black Friday, for 30 seconds, let's take a look on what was going on inside these Walmarts and Kmarts where shoppers were like, this is like the final outcome or the final end game of capitalism, right? It's consumption of the fittest. Remember the person who got trampled a couple years ago?
Any reports of anyone, being trampled or anything awful like that? But there have been some problems for sure at a Kmart in Sacramento. One guy threatened to stab people.
Mother f***, push one of my keys. I will stab one of you, mother.
Now the people around him laugh, but he says he was not joking.
And there was a lot of screaming and yelling, and it just wasn't safe at all.
That's a whole different conversation that we're not going to get into, but yeah, that's also worth mentioning.
The consumerism.
That, you know, what is the really final outcome of capitalism? Well, it's consumption of the fittest. Consumption.
I got to say too, as a side note, just in watching the horrific charade of the corporate media regarding Black Friday. Mm-hmm. You never heard them refer to, human beings or, people who are out. They were always just shoppers. Shoppers was the noun, describing people who are out buying things, not, you know, a husband and wife or son and daughter or any of these things. They were just shoppers. And I think it was really quite dehumanizing, quite frankly, to hear, you know, when they're just covering the mayhem that related around Black Friday. And even worse, the fact of the matter was that the media, that's really all they talked about was a shopping day as if it's news, you know, which is really quite surreal. But anyway.
Yeah. Well, it's the biggest shopping day of the year, Scott, don't you know? Duh.
That's why it's 24-hour coverage of it. I mean, over and over again. We have a live camera waiting to see someone get trampled. Let's see it. You know, it's like, it was just, it's really just bizarre. But
well, and some of the on-scene reporting wasn't half bad. Actually, I want to give a tip of the hat to CNN for actually, I think it was CNN, for actually covering a little bit of the Walmart protest in Landover, Maryland, there in suburbia, Washington, D.C., over by Scott. I want to play a couple of clips real quick from that before we take a break. I want to come back and play a couple of clips from the Vice President of Walmart Communications, a.k.a. the bullshitter propagandist-in-chief car salesman, on what he had to say on an interview with Stuart Varney on Fox. It will make you blow your mind, really. It really will.
That's pretty funny.
And then also, we're going to share some really cool live, you know, activism man on the street protesting stuff that I did here in Portland and what happened at the big protest here in Portland, where actually my city commissioner, Amanda Fritz, showed up and gave a little speech and was supporting. And there was a couple hundred people.
Oh, very cool.
There was a couple hundred people at the Walmart, like just 3 minutes from my house protesting. So I want to share that with you as well. But here is... And we'll do that right after the break here. But here is an interview with a worker, a Walmart worker in Maryland who was on strike supporting the protests.
Ma'am, are you an employee?
I am a worker from Laurel, Maryland, 1985 store.
Okay, so you are, and now did you walk out today?
Yes, I did. We are both on strike. She's also a worker. We are here to support our brothers and sisters across the United States in our Walmart stores, our Walmart warehouses, and more. I hope there will be no more retaliation when I go back to our stores tomorrow, because we are returning to work tomorrow.
That begs a question. I mean, would you be comfortable walking off your job on a strike and coming into work the next day? But think about that one, and then I want to play this next clip real quick. Talking about, again, you know, why
I
are these...
I hope she called in sick, they don't know it was her.
No, there you go. why are
I mean,
these...
it's just plausible deniability, you know?
Why are these people protesting again? Oh, maybe it has something to do with the fact that you can work at Walmart for 4 years and not... still make more than $10 an hour. What's up with that?
You obviously, you're out here, you agree with that. Tell me how pay has affected or impacted you at all. Do you want to see more pay? And what are your thoughts as far as wages go?
We want them to give us a living wage. That's one of the things that we're asking for. We can't afford health care. Why should we work 40 hours and have to go to the government to get medical assistance or food stamps to make our families being able just to live a basic life? We're not asking for anything that workers don't work for inside those Walmart stores. It is our sweat and blood that gives them their billions that they're making. Instead of keep taking them from us, all we're asking is that they give back in return. We're not asking them to give us anything. We work hard, and so we just want a decent wage, a fair living. And we're tired of broken shifts. We're tired of them not scheduling people right. I mean, how could you live off one day a week or 20 hours a week? We can't do it. And they're making billions.
It's really a cry for independency. And that really is kind of like a basic human want. That comes back to natural human instinct, to want to be able to be independent on your own, support yourself, have a good...
being empowered.
Right. Yeah. Yeah. It's empowerment. Here's the... Now, this is where, of course, the mainstream corporate-owned media takes a turn and makes you a little bit sick to your stomach. They end this conversation by doing everything that they can to not be factually wrong, but to diminish what's going on here. Listen to this conversation between the reporter on the scene and the news anchor back in the studio.
And Renee, just to clarify, the blonde woman you were talking to, does she work in a Walmart warehouse? Does she work in a Walmart store?
She says that she works at a Walmart store, not this Walmart, but she says that she works at a Walmart store, Carol.
So most of the people, at least as far as you can determine now, are not actual Walmart workers.
As far as I can tell, I mean, the majority of people that I've seen or that I've spoken to, they are members of unions. They are people within the community that sympathize with the workers at Walmart. But the majority of the people that you're seeing here, at least from the people that I've been able to speak to, they are not specifically Walmart workers.
You see, they're not really Walmart. They're not actual Walmart workers, as if, you know, they're not actual real people. So we shouldn't really actually be putting this on the news, and this shouldn't actually matter, right? No, it's not that simple of an answer to a complicated problem here. Most of the protesters outside these Walmarts aren't Walmart workers, because the Walmart workers are busting their ass so much to try to maintain a poverty lifestyle. Don't you get it? You see the big picture here? More Filter-Free Radio when we come back. Jacob Dean, Skeptical Scott with you. FilterFreeRadio.com, RadioOrNot.com, and ProgressiveBlendRadio.com. Don't go anywhere. We will be right back.
Your number one source for undiluted truth, analysis, and solutions. Filter-Free Radio on Radio or Not and FilterFreeRadio.com.
You're listening to WIN, Workers Independent News, a production of Diversified Media Enterprises. I'm Doug Cunningham. This is a Black Friday like no other for the world's largest retailer. Walmart workers today are striking, and their supporters are boycotting Walmart. The Black Friday action comes after years of Walmart workers struggling to improve wages and working conditions and efforts to organize unions at Walmart. Walmart is intensely anti-union, but workers earlier this year at warehouses handling Walmart merchandise in Illinois and California united to demand improved conditions and walked off their jobs. Stephen French is a Milwaukee Walmart worker who will be part of today's Black Friday protest.
Walmart is a billion-dollar company, and yet a lot of its associates, you know, still depend on state aid, you know, to survive through life. What we're going to be doing is actually a walkout in protest to the unfair way that Walmart associates have been treated by the upper management in regards to our voices not be heard in different policies that we have issues with and are currently trying to just find our voices so that we can get different policies changed.
French says Walmart workers are standing up to demand a voice on the job and wages that really support a family.
We want our voices to be heard, and it's we feel as if like we've been silenced for so long now, and it's time for a change. It would be nice to see a union, because then it's nice to know that that there are other people out there that feel the same way we do, and you know, and have better means to see that some of these things come through fruition, you know.
Walmart workers want a living wage of at least $25,000 a year and quality, affordable health care coverage. They also want an end to Walmart's retaliation against workers who unite to speak out to improve their working conditions. Supporters of Walmart workers will be at stores nationwide on this Black Friday to stand with Walmart workers. Sensata workers losing their jobs to China are still pressing the company for a full year's severance pay. The workers camped near the Sensata plant in Freeport, Illinois, at a tent city called Bainport during the presidential campaign to draw attention to Mitt Romney's Bain capital. Bain owns Sensata and shipped 170 jobs to China. Sensata worker Tom Gallrap says the Bainport workers stand in solidarity with Walmart workers.
We want the people who are struggling here for good jobs to have a future like our present was before our jobs were being outsourced. And we want to show solidarity with them and show them that working people sticking together can do anything.
You've been listening to WIN, Workers Independent News. For more information, visit laborradio.org.
The More Me Show with DJ Downtown and Eddie Herradura. Live from our nation's capital. Every Sunday at 5 p.m. Eastern, with hilariously scathing inches from the beltway analysis of this week's political and social developments. The More Me Show at ProgressiveBlendRadio.com and RadioOrNot.com.
Disappointed yet again by Sunday morning political talk shows brought to you by the mainstream media? Don't let them ruin your Mondays.
Sounds like somebody's got a case of the Mondays.
There's a fresh way, a filter-free way, to jumpstart your news week. On Monday nights, come experience Jacob Dean, host of Filter Free Radio.
He is the most interesting man in the world.
Finally, there's a radio talker who will arm you with the real facts, all the facts, and guide you through the labyrinth of fake news and false punditry. Each week, Jacob Dean throws out all those worn-out memes, crystallizes important issues, champions progressive causes, and features constructive solutions. That's Filter Free Radio, every Monday night from 7 to 9 p.m. Eastern, on the Ustream home of Nicole Sandler, RadioOrNot.com, and FilterFreeRadio.com, the official website of Filter Free Radio.
Never know who or what you'll hear when you listen to the Nicole Sandler Show at RadioOrNot.com.
Your view is not being represented in this country because all of our views have been corrupted by money and politics. Remember, 94% of the time, the candidate who raises the most money wins.
That's the fact that we need to drive home constantly. It's all about the money. Dylan Radigan, you rock.
The Nicole Sandler Show, live Monday through Thursdays at 10 a.m. Eastern, or podcast anytime at RadioOrNot.com.
This is Stephanie Miller.
Hey, this is Hal Sparks from the Hal Sparks radio program, Mega Worldwide.
This is Nicole Bell of CrooksandLiars.com.
I'm Brad Friedman.
Hi, I'm cartoonist and agent provocateur, P.S. Mueller.
And this is Filter Free Radio with Jacob Dean and Skeptical Scott.
Filter Free Radio.
You're listening to Filter Free Radio with Jacob Dean.
Filter Free Radio with Jacob Dean and Skeptical Scott.
FilterFreeRadio.com.
And now, back to Jacob and Scott.
And welcome back. A little spicy, I don't know, Hawaiian guitar music there for you. We're a couple days away from December. It's pretty cold just about everywhere, so I figured we'll spice it up a little bit, warm us up there. Good to be back with you live on Radio or Not, Progressive Blend Radio, and our website, filterfreeradio.com, where you can check out post interviews, highlights from the program, all sorts of free, and it's all free, 100% free video archives and audio archives, all good, all a bunch of good stuff over there, so go check it out. Let's go right to some really cool stuff that I want to show you. Before I show you the video and coverage that I took at protest here in Portland at the Walmart. This is a video, a really bad video, and I apologize for the quality on that, of the same exact spot where I was, at the same exact Walmart that I went to, but at this was at 10 o'clock in the morning on Black Friday, and you see there are a ton of folks there. There was estimates of a couple hundred people there. And from what I'm understanding, it was understood that, it was planned out that folks would show up there at around 10 o'clock in the morning and start the protest then. I didn't get to the Walmart due to some other things I was dealing with until about 1:30, 2 o'clock in the afternoon. And there were still folks there, but that brings up a...
Slacker.
But that brings up a 2 points. One, how do we get the word out about protests happening around us that we need to know about? And two, because I didn't find out about it until it was almost over. And two, sustainability of demonstrations. I want to talk about what I mean by that in just a second. But here's a really cool video that I want to share with you from some awesome independent journalists and folks who were there at the Walmart in Southeast Portland on Black Friday at 10 o'clock in the morning and caught the really exciting part of the protest. And then I'll share my interview with a really interesting activist who had some really cool stuff to talk about as far as dead peasant insurance is concerned. And what I mean by that, I'll share with you next, right after this. So watch this. This is my local Walmart, 3 minutes away from where I'm talking to you right now on Black Friday. And to tell you, this is kind of in a rebuttal to a clip I'll play from the Walmart VP of Communications in a couple of minutes. Oh, we don't care about them. They're not doing anything. It doesn't matter. No one's really actually showing up and getting active. BS. Here's the proof, at least in Portland where I am. And it's like not even that big of a deal, right?
Hello, folks. Mobile T here with JoeAnybody.com. I'm down here at the Eastport Plaza Walmart, where several protesters, actually over 200 protesters, have been protesting this morning from 10:30 a.m. on, and even since last night, the Black Friday sale out here at Walmart. Since Walmart seems to be the most highest in capital gains of businesses in the country, and still continues to treat their employees bad and poorly, and offer them low wages and part-time hours so that they can't obtain health care, these protesters are out here in lieu of that, protesting that, and hoping that Walmart brings a change and starts treating their workers fairly. Once again, this is Mobile T down here at the Eastport Walmart, covering the protest with JoeAnybody.com. Thank you.
It doesn't matter who we work for. We all want respect. We're all fighting for the same thing. We want respect.
What do we want?
Respect.
What do we want?
Respect.
What do we want?
Respect.
What do they want, Andrew?
I mean, they want respect.
Yeah.
Today, we are making history. Thanks to the Americans at Walmart. We are the Americans. So, finally, what I want to say is that solidarity is what helps to build this movement, too.
Yeah.
That's why we all are here today. Thanks to all of you, to the unions, to the community organizations, to the people of Portland and this area. Thank you very much for coming in solidarity. Just with justice builds and helps to build that. So we are asking you, if you are here, didn't sign the pledge. We have a pledge that we all know, many of us know that. The very simple pledge is that you come out and again to support five struggles. Let's let him come by.
Maybe they're going to pick up the criminals in Walmart.
Maybe. The workers are getting a heart attack today. There we go. So I was saying that if you want to sign, you didn't sign the pledge, please sign it. We have here, raise your hand, my friend, with the yellow Walmart sad sign. And also, Steve, are you going to help with that too? We are going to pass around the pledge cards that you are going to say and commit to come out to fight more actions and support workers like the Walmart workers during the year. Of course, many of you do 20 or 30 or 40, right? But just in case. Anyway, so thank you very much, and I want to get to the next person.
I'd like to let them know that if I sign it, they get the information that they'll be notified of these things.
Let's hear it for jobs and justice!
Hello, y'all. I'm really excited to see all of you folks here supporting Walmart workers. A delegation of four workers, including myself, went in and talked to the store manager. And we gave him a letter supporting those workers. And then the recently elected city commissioner, Amanda Frank, is going to be here. Please say hello to Amanda.
Black Friday in support of brave Walmart associates across the country who are on strike demanding respect. Associates, mothers and fathers, sons and daughters, spouses working hard every day to support their families have been speaking out for good jobs with decent pay, regular hours, affordable health care. Let's hear it. Walmart a better place to work and shop, Walmart has attempted to silence them and has retaliated against them for speaking out. Their jobs have been threatened, their hours cut, their schedules changed. Some have been fired. Boo! This holiday season, Walmart will rake in billions of dollars in profits. The Walton family have an estimated net worth of $115 billion. No family needs that much money. Meanwhile, Walmart associates struggle to pay the bills as they earn poverty wages. That is unacceptable. We call on Walmart to change.
Thank you.
Walmart must pay associates a living wage. It must provide affordable health care. President Obama for Obamacare. Full-time hours for those who want them and enough staffing to serve the customers.
Yeah!
And then we will become customers, right?
Yes.
Our community stands with these brave Walmart workers and will continue to support them until we see real change at Walmart. Yeah! 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 And my future colleague, Commissioner Alexis. Steve Novick was here earlier, I don't know if he's still here. Former mayoral candidate, former treasurer candidate, we have our witness here. We are all here because we care about Walmart, and we care about Walmart workers in particular, and we care about Portland being a better place to live, work, and shop, right?
Yeah!
Thank you all for being here.
Yeah! Marco.
All right, thank you very much for coming again, as I said before. With solidarity and all of us here mobilizing every day is how we're going to change this country.
Yeah! Yeah! Tell them, Marco!
We're going to continue supporting Walmart workers, and we're not going to let these other 15 or 17 stores that they want to bring to the area. Are we going to let them come here?
No!
There we go, of course not. And we're going to, as Amanda said, we're going to go and shop locally.
Yeah.
Those people in there don't think that because they're here they're local, but we know it's not, right?
Right.
So let's promote the local economy and the local shopping to the stores that we know in our neighborhood. So now, Paul is going to help us with a couple of chants before we finish.
Okay, we're going to say Walmart workers, and then you guys are going to say respect, and we're going to do it until we can't do it no more. What do Walmart workers want?
Respect!
What do Walmart workers want?
Respect!
What do Walmart workers want?
Respect!
What do you think Walmart workers want?
Respect!
Respect!
And there you go. One of the speeches there, the woman speaking, that was actually my city commissioner, Amanda Fritz, who won re-election this year, who I voted for. Woohoo! And so, actually,
wow,
had some...
That's pretty much your mayor.
City official, actually elected official showing up in support. And I wanted to share that with you only because that was a really awesome video and that highlights exactly, that gives you a real perception, a more accurate perception of what was going on, because that protest at my local Walmart was scheduled to happen and come together at 10 o'clock in the morning. At 10 o'clock in the morning, that's what you just watched, right? So in the meantime... and this is how it works. Then a few hundred people show up to protest Walmart at 10 o'clock in the morning. By 11 o'clock, a few people have tweeted about it or Facebooked about it. By 12 o'clock, it hits the ears of myself. Actually, a friend of mine who works at the Jack in the Box right next to this protest Facebooked me a picture of the protest outside of what was going on. And that's how I found out about it. And then I showed up. I didn't get there till 2 o'clock, but I showed up as well, took a few pictures, put together a little video, and I want to share that video with you now, but I had to play this one that we just showed you first so you actually get the idea of, like I said, a better perception of what's more accurate of what happened that day, because in the video I'm about to show you, when I got there at 1:30, there was only 6 people there with signs. And here's the kicker. I tell you that because it takes a little while for the word to spread around. When I was there, the local news, local NBC affiliate of Portland, Channel 8 KGW, showed up to do some coverage of the event. By 1:30, everyone's gone. And so anyone who only saw the coverage on Channel 8 when they aired their story, that saw only like 5 or 6 of us standing there, probably don't get that accurate perception of what I just showed you. So,
Damn, that's a shame. I mean, that sounds like the protest only lasted like an hour or two.
Yeah, so that brings up a question of like sustainability in demonstrations. And what if, the organizers of that demonstration had prepared and planned and prepped and prepared for a more longer lasting demonstration there for going on for a few hours, then you would have had more, or at least more accurate local news coverage. And
yeah, I would say 8 to 10 hours at least, just to get people, you know, to maintain that initial surge of volume of people, just to get, you know, by the time everyone else shows up and hears about it, like you said, and even, of course, the corporate media, by the time they get there, I mean, it's hours from when you start, you know?
Yeah. So let me share this video with you that I took when I'm like, oh my goodness, I got this thing from my friend. This is people are at our Walmart, or, you know, referred to it ours as in the one that's closest to us. And not that I shop there, which I don't. And but I was part of the problem on Black Friday or the night before. I went to Target and I purchased a camera, and I love the camera and it's great. It was made in Indonesia. But then that guilted me so much into I had to show up the next morning once I found out that there was a protest going on at my Walmart just down the street, 3 to 5 minutes away from me. And I have this to
share
with you.
At least you felt guilty, right?
I have this video to share with you from that. Your cashier how they feel about dead peasant insurance. Part of the Black Friday protests out here, Walmart in Southeast Portland, Oregon, with one of the activist protesters out here on the streets.
Right.
Man, tell me, what brought you out here in the rain to protest the Walmart?
Well, you know, I'm here visiting family for Thanksgiving, and I didn't work for Walmart, but I heard about their whole deal where they would they buy out insurance for their sick and their sick employees that are soon to die, and then when they die, they collect a profit on it, and they don't give any to the families or anything. And I just think that's criminal, and it shouldn't be allowed, but it is, and it's actually allowed by a lot of companies. And so I just thought that this is something that if more people knew about it, they might not just sit back and let it happen. So.
Yeah, and tell me about your sign. I love it. The ask your cashier about how they feel about dead peasant insurance. That's kind of your point there, isn't it?
Well, yeah. I mean, I think if people are coming to Walmart to shop, they're probably not going to turn around when they see some protesters. I probably wouldn't either. But you know, if they just see the sign and they think when they get up to the cashier to ask them how they actually feel about the fact that there might be an insurance policy on them, and that if they die they'll that Walmart will actually probably get more money than they ever made in their entire career, I think that maybe even the employees might you know, look a little bit deeper into that, and maybe second guess what they're, you know, what they're supporting.
If we could get, I mean, that's the whole idea of getting the Walmart workers on your side, getting, you know, in cases of, like, we see the Occupy military crackdowns, you want to get the police on your side.
Yeah,
these
right.
kinds of things. If you can reach out across that aisle or that divide and say, hey, look, brother, we're with you.
Totally.
We're all in this together, you know.
Yeah, I mean, you talk about the police. I mean, I was just thinking about, you know, what if the government had life insurance policies on the police department? You know, how would each what would a police officer feel like, or a military guy? You know, it's just completely wrong. I mean, if I found out that my employer had an insurance policy on my life, I wouldn't feel safe working for them. And so, I think it's hopefully it'll wake up Walmart workers to kind of shake things up and not back down to the corporate giants, I guess.
That was a fun conversation. I really
Very
enjoyed
cool,
it.
Very cool, man.
And I wanted to thank that guy again for his time. That was really cool. So there you go. I mean, I did participate. I will admit I was part of the problem, like I said, but also I was part of the solution. I did show up.
Yeah.
Once I found out about it.
60-40 there, man.
Yeah. So, so that was really
good on you for getting out there and getting some footage too. I mean, it's, you know, if all you watch is ABC and NBC, you certainly don't get that kind of coverage, you know,
and I
didn't even watch Fox News, but the general corporate media, I mean, just they pay lip service to it as if they said, oh, this is happening. Well, here's Walmart's issued press statement. And then let's talk about Black Friday. That was like about the length of time Brian Williams or anybody else spent on it. And that's, you know, not even including Fox News. So good on you for getting out there and actually interviewing somebody and getting some footage. And I mean, it was a cold, rainy day. I can't imagine anybody want to be out there protesting.
Yeah. And good on the fellow who did the report there beforehand, at the 10 o'clock gathering there, the video that we showed. A big, you know, thanks to that fellow for getting out and doing some independent work there.
Very nice.
Unlike the lapdog shill television pop propaganda pushing crap sickening rather that is Fox. I gotta share this before we go to the break to sum up the Walmart discussion here. So okay, we've been a little unfair against Walmart. Okay, let's hear what the other side of the story has to say. I'll give them a fair shot. It's the least I can do here. This is Stuart Varney on Fox interviewing the vice president of Walmart Communications. The vice president of communications of Walmart. That is basically the vice president of the spin machine, or the car salesman, or the bullshitter, or the propagandist. Your adjective insert there. Here we go.
And it's rolling up its sleeves.
Oh, here we go. I got to start that over.
Walmart's rolling back the prices, and it's rolling up its sleeves in a major fight against the unions.
Oh, my God.
On Black Friday, unions are planning to help Walmart workers stage a massive walkout, complete with flash mobs and justice-themed caroling. But Walmart is fighting back by filing a complaint against one of the biggest unions. David Tovar is Walmart's vice president of communications. David, you've taken on the United Food and Commercial Workers Union, I believe. You filed this complaint against them. Is that enough to stop any walkout the day after Thanksgiving? Our viewers, maybe some Walmart shoppers, they want to know, are they going to hit these roadblocks?
Yeah, hi, Stuart. Thanks for having me on the show today. I'm glad you allow me to set the record straight, because we don't think any of that's going to have any impact on our ability to serve our customers on Black Friday. We're excited about a great Black Friday event that we're going to have this year, and we're really going to delight our customers. We've got some great items, unbelievable prices, and we think Black Friday at Walmart this year is going to be awesome.
It's going to be awesome. Wow, look at that spin machine.
Wow, I just love how Stuart Varney opens up with their Walmart slogan. I mean, we're slashing prices all over the store. It's unbelievable.
If that doesn't make you sick, the way that, you know, of course, and that's the job of your vice president of communications. Dodge any question that, you know, is a relevant question.
It was even a softball question, though. I mean, come on. It was just such a friendly atmosphere. I can't believe he couldn't even give him a straight answer.
And it go immediately to your talking point of Black Friday sale. Plug, 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 chug, chug, chug. To take us into the break, I want to play this next clip, and just, this is going to blow your mind.
And we think Black Friday at Walmart this year is going to be awesome.
Okay, now you filed a complaint against the United Food and Commercial Workers Union. You said, hey, stop messing around with our business. Can you sue them? Can you take him for any money if your complaint is valid?
Yeah, we filed that complaint last week, and now it's in the hands of the labor board, and we'll let them sort that out and figure it out. We think what they're doing is illegal. They've been doing these kind of demonstrations for more than 30 days. But this week, like I said, we're focused like a laser on Black Friday, and we think it's going to be an awesome day at Walmart this year.
I mean, David, I got it. I know you're out there doing your best for Walmart, but look, can you stop these protests? Will this complaint, this labor complaint, will it stop the protests?
Well, we hope so. I mean, you know, we think that the labor board put out a statement today. They said this is their top priority. But let's get one thing straight here. You know, don't believe everything you read in a union press release.
Believe everything the vice president of communications of Walmart
says
either.
We've seen some of these events before. It's usually a handful of associates at a handful of stores across the country. We've got 4,000 stores, and we've got 1.3 million associates. And
we're
going to have millions of customers in our stores that day.
Okay.
And that's what we're focused on.
David, I want to know how sharp-edged you're going to be. You got a fight on your hands. I want to know how rough Walmart's going to be. For example, if some of your workers walk off the job on Black Friday, will you fire them?
Yeah, it's going to depend on the situation. We're going to take each of those on a case-by-case basis. We don't think a couple of sporadic events across the country that the unions may do is going to have any impact whatsoever.
You don't matter. The only thing that matters is the billions in profits that will be coming in via our sales on Black Friday. Don't you get it? You don't mean shit. It doesn't matter. Okay, we got to take a break. It is top of the hour. We'll be right back with more conversation that is unfiltered, that you can't get anywhere else in the filtered media. We're talking real big picture climate change stuff. Here, Jacob Dean and Skeptical Scott with you live from Portland, Oregon and Washington, D.C. on our official website, filterfreeradio.com. Click on Watch and Chat Live, or check us out at radioornot.com, the home of Nicole Sandler, and progressiveblendradio.com. Don't go anywhere. Scott and I will be right back.
You're listening and watching Unfiltered Independent Media. Participate now in the chat room on filterfreeradio.com.
This is Stephanie Miller.
Hi, this is Tom Harbin.
Hello, everybody. I'm David Schuster of Take Action News.
I'm Brad Friedman of bradblog.com.
Hi, I'm cartoonist and agent provocateur P.S. Mueller.
This is Nicole Bell of crooksandliars.com, and this is...
You're listening to
and watching
Filter Free Radio.
Filter Free Radio.
Filter Free Radio with Jacob Dean and Skeptical Scott.
Jacob Dean.
With Jacob Dean and Skeptical Scott.
Shopping locally, simply, you keep the money locally in the local economy. It does not get sucked up into the Walmart billionaire pocketbook. No.
Doesn't it go back to Bentonville, Arkansas?
Right. It actually stays in the local shopkeeper who owns that local store that you purchased at in the local economy and shops local. If everyone just shopped locally, the economy could probably see significant changes in 5-10 years just simply doing that one thing alone. But then you would tell a few who are really, really rich and powerful that you can't have more billions and trillions. And we all know what people want when they have a lot of something. They want just a little bit more.
FilterFreeRadio.com.
The window is narrow. We've got to take action now.
Conservative World Bank warns of catastrophic climate change.
It's a turning point in history. It's a milestone.
For the first time ever, Motor Trend's car of the year is all electric. Carbon dioxide emissions reach record highs. EPA slams Alaska's proposed pebble mine. Plus,
they will burn it unless we figure out how to slow them down.
Urging universities to divest from fossil fuel companies.
All of that and more straight ahead. From bradblog.com, I'm Brad Friedman.
And I'm Desi Doyen.
Stand by for 6 minutes of independent green news, politics, analysis, and snarky comment.
What's the solution to global warming? We don't need one, because it isn't real. And even if it is, big whoop, just buy an air conditioner, you
There you go. Problem solved. This is your Green News Report. Okay, Desi Doyen, we're happy to welcome aboard our newest affiliate partner, Ohio's Progressive Talk, WVKO, 1580 AM in Columbus. Welcome aboard, guys.
Indeed. Columbus rocks.
Indeed they do. What do you have for us today, Des?
Well, first, Thanksgiving is this week, and that's a great reminder that it's time to green up your holidays and see where you can reduce the waste your family generates and choose earth-friendly products from companies that practice social responsibility. You can check out companies and product ratings at thegreatgoodguide.com. On to the news.
This report is a sobering look at what a 4 degrees Celsius warmer world would look like.
The World Bank is calling on world governments to take action to avoid catastrophic climate change. In a new report commissioned by the World Bank with the subtle title, Turn Down the Heat, the Potsdam Institute warns that the world is on track to see a 4 degrees Celsius rise in global temperatures. That's over 7 degrees Fahrenheit. That's due to our continued emissions of greenhouse gases from burning fossil fuels. They warn that climate destabilization will cause, quote, massive disruptions of our most basic systems, unquote, that will impact all nations, and poor, underdeveloped nations will be hit hardest by extreme heat waves, widespread crop failures, and rising sea levels. World Bank President Jim Yong Kim says he hopes the projections shock people into action.
You know, I have a 3-year-old son, and when he's my age, he could be living in a completely different world, one in which we don't have enough food to feed our population, one in which cities are inundated with water. And the window is narrow. We've got to take action now.
Well, boo-hoo, end of the world. Oh, well.
Well, that World Bank report was published in advance of the next round of UN International Climate Treaty negotiations that begin next week in Doha, Qatar.
The next round of UN negotiations begins next week?
Yes, they do.
Why don't they get together earlier and start not accomplishing anything right now?
That's a good point. But climate activist Bill McKibben is taking a message of action to colleges and universities as part of his nationwide Do the Math tour, here in this video from 350.org.
It turns out that the fossil fuel industry has 5 times more coal and oil and gas in its reserves than even the most conservative government in the world thinks would be safe to burn. But they will burn it unless we figure out how to slow them down.
In hopes of slowing them down, McKibben's group, 350.org, has launched a divestiture campaign to help college students convince their universities to divest from investments in fossil fuels. It's modeled on a similar campaign by U.S. college students in the 1980s that helped end apartheid in South Africa. Meanwhile, the concentration of heat-trapping carbon dioxide in the atmosphere is on the rise again after taking a dip due to the global Great Recession, says the World Meteorological Organization. Atmospheric CO2 in 2011 reached a record high, as did levels of other heat-trapping gases like methane that have also climbed to record levels. The Environmental Protection Agency has issued its final assessment of the controversial Pebble Mine project proposed for Alaska's pristine Bristol Bay area. The EPA says in no uncertain terms that there is no way the mine cannot impact the most prolific salmon fishery in the world. As one activist said of the report, quote, "You can have salmon for 1,000 years or mining for 50 years, but you can't have both." Finally, for the first time ever, an all-electric car has won Motor Trend Magazine's Car of the Year.
Cool.
In a first-ever unanimous decision, the Tesla all-electric Model S sedan won the 2013 Car of the Year award, the first time ever for any car not powered by gasoline. Although Tesla cars are way too expensive for most Americans, founder and CEO Elon Musk tells CNBC that long gas lines after Hurricane Sandy showed electric cars are the future.
I think it adds some additional urgency to shift to a sustainable form of transport.
Well, it's about time. It's also about time someone loans me an electric car so I can talk about it on the Green News Report. For much more on all of the stories that we covered today and those that we couldn't get to, please check out our website at greennews.bradblog.com. While you're there, please consider a donation to help sponsor the Green News Report so we can stay on your public airwaves. Remember, you can download us anytime via iTunes, listen to us on your mobile device via Stitcher Radio, find us and like us on the Facebook, and follow us 24/7 on the Twitters at Green News Report. We're taking Thursday off for Thanksgiving, but we'll see you next week from bradblog.com. I'm Brad Friedman.
And I'm Desi Doyen.
And this has been your Green News Report. Put your motor-
Looking for filters? Check your coffee maker. This is Filter Free Radio with Jacob Dean and Skeptical Scott. FilterFreeRadio.com. Get ready to suck down some grounds.
When I talk about resistance, I think we have to stand up now and carry out acts of nonviolent resistance.
Because the truth is, we do have power.
We live in revolutionary times, but the counter-revolution is winning.
Sounds like a case of the Mondays.
Live Monday and Wednesday from 7 to 9 p.m. Eastern. FilterFreeRadio.com.
This is my favorite show.
We have been given an opportunity to make a new beginning.
I think it's very important for us to start to build a culture of resistance because what we're doing isn't working, clearly.
Call the Filter Free Radio comment line, 202-6979-FFR.
It's our job to very coldly assess reality and then figure out how to respond.
Your number one source for unfiltered truth, analysis, and solutions, FilterFreeRadio.com.
And welcome to the second hour of the program. Humans must immediately implement a series of radical measures to halt carbon emissions or prepare for the collapse of entire ecosystems. Oh, and by the way, also the displacement, suffering, and death of hundreds of millions of our globe's inhabitants and co-inhabitants, according to a report commissioned by the World Bank. This is Chris Hedges writing today at truthdig.com. Ladies and gentlemen, time to stand still for the apocalypse. Jacob Dean and Skeptical Scott here with you live from Portland, Oregon, Washington, D.C., November 26th. Second hour of the program. Scott, let's get into the climate change discussion. We've got some cool stuff to share with you about some protests and activism going on in the nation's capital in Washington, D.C., thanks to awesome work by Bill McKibben and the folks at 350.org. We'll get to that in just a couple of minutes. Also, I want to share some really important messages from Bill, who's been on this program many a times, and we've got to reach out and get Bill back on this program soon to kind of give us an update on really where we're going here. But how to talk to skeptics, or how to talk, yeah, Scott, you. No, how to talk to climate skeptics. I don't think you're skeptical of climate change, but...
not at all, jeez.
But unfortunately, there's some folks out there who are, and we'll break down exactly how no one anymore, any longer, can argue against climate change. Thanks to Bill McKibben. But first, I want to get into this Chris Hedges article from today at truthdig.com, Scott, with you. And
can I diverge for 1 second?
Yeah, go
just
ahead.
Just to clear up, last hour we talked about dead peasants insurance. The actual legal term for that is corporate-owned life insurance, COLI, COLI. Is the acronym for it. Or if you happen to work for a bank, it's known as bank-owned life insurance, or BOLI, B-O-L-I. But yeah, there's actually legal terms for dead peasants insurance. It's corporate-owned life insurance, COLI. So anyway.
No, that's really important. We ended the last hour conversation about Walmart with that video, and it's up on the front page of filterfreeradio.com right now if you want to watch it. But about midways through, I start this interview with one of the folks, one of the activists who was there when I showed up, and he really, and his sign really grabbed my attention. He said, ask your cashier how they feel about dead peasant insurance. And so I asked him about his sign, and that conversation is up on our website in case you just missed it, or if you're just joining us, you can go watch that. But yeah, thanks for hammering that home, Scott, because yeah, that's really important. And a really interesting kind of paradigm shift to think about there. But looking at this on this article, stand still for the apocalypse. Oh, that's always got to be that's an intriguing introduction there, Mr. Hedges, writing over at truthdig.com again, referencing this 84-page document titled "Turn Down the Heat: Why a 4 degrees Celsius Warmer World Must Be Avoided," written for the World Bank by the Potsdam Institute for Climate Impact Research and Climate So, and this was published last week, and my apologies if I'm mispronouncing this. But basically, it paints this picture of a world with rising temperatures, never-ending rising temperatures. And it's a mixture of, like, kind of mass chaos and systems collapsing and medical suffering. And not just you and me and brothers and sisters and the human being species, but all of the other co-inhabitants on this planet as well. You know, we tend to think that we're, like, the only ones here, right? But like, the worst... It's like that of the worst of the Black Plague kind of thing, which, you know, if you recall, early 14th century history kind of wiped out like 30 to 40, 50% of the population. so this report, it's no real laughing matter, but I laugh because it's, you know, it's kind of scary. This report comes as the annual United Nations Conference on Climate Change begins today. Did you know that? The United Nations Conference on Climate Change started today. And so this is kind of why we really need to be talking about this. Not just that, but this is like the one of the most important things that we need to be fighting for here and now and into the near future. And we'll talk with Bill McKibben, founder of 350.org, a little bit more about how and why and where and the next steps in just a couple of minutes. But back to this Chris Hedges article.
You have Bill McKibben on?
No. Well, I have clips to play from. It's, you know, it's easier it's easier to do it that way, and then I get the sound bites that I need and I want, and it just works better though. No. Actually, Bill, I've reached out to him, and he's come on this program every time that we've asked him to. And so that's the honest truth. And we need to ask him to come on again. But I use those sparingly because I know he's super busy. And I'd much rather see Bill McKibben on much bigger outlets with much bigger reaches because that's more important to me. Because I can play the clips here that we want to hear, right, Scott? So... No,
absolutely. Plus, you got some good audio from that I heard earlier. So
yeah, well, okay. I'll wrap up I'll read one more section of this Chris Hedges article, then we'll get to that. A planet-wide temperature rise of 4 degrees Celsius would basically mean, first of all, start with a drop in crop yields, like we saw last year. Remember the drought and everything, the loss of many different fish species.
Oh, this year.
This year, rather, right, yeah. Disappearing of fish species resulting in widespread hunger, starvation. Hundreds of millions of people will be forced to move, relocate homes in coastal areas and on islands that will be submerged as sea levels rise. Oh, yeah, and by the way, Republicans making jokes about this as if it's like, you know, a funny inside joke at the Republican National Convention. I just want to play this.
President Obama promised to begin to slow the rise of the oceans.
The reason that they're laughing is because they're all thinking in the back of their heads, yeah, right, asshole, not with my gigantic Ford 350 gas-guzzling, polluting hog dog outside, right? Planet.
My promise. Corporations are people, my friend.
No, okay, I'm sorry. I slightly edited that, but that was kind of funny. Anyways, I play that just...
Well, the thing too is that, I mean, why they're laughing is because they think it's in God's hands. They don't think you can control that kind of stuff. I mean, what Mitt Romney was saying in that subtext is that Obama thinks he's God.
And
that's, you know, those people, those are the people, at least the audience in which he was addressing, are the ones that are like, what do you think we should do about climate change? Well, we should pray about it. You know what I mean? That's the kind of mentality that they have.
And by the way, Bill McKibben is a Methodist Sunday school teacher, and he'll explain in just a second. That's the first clip I'm going to play of why even religious people need to realize that climate change is real and we're not being good stewards of this earth for our brothers and sisters and generations to come. These kinds
exactly.
of things.
Exactly.
Hello, big picture.
You can't just pray about it. You got to actually do God's will. Come on, people.
Thank you. Yeah. All right. Amen. There we go. All right. So real quick. You know, the planet's going to warm up. The sea level's going to rise. Look at the melting glaciers and stuff already. There is going to be an explosion in diseases such as malaria. and dengue fever, devastating heat waves and droughts and floods, especially in the tropics. It's going to render parts of our habitat uninhabitable, like Super Frankenstorm Sandy on the East Coast. Some folks are still without power. A lot of folks are still without homes. The rainforest covering the Amazon basin will disappear. Coral reefs will vanish. Numerous animal and plant species, many of which are vital to sustaining our human species populations, will vanish, become extinct. You'll have monster storms that are going to eradicate the biodiversity along with whole cities and communities here. I want to play some Bill McKibben audio. This is the first clip that I want to play, and this is kind of sets up the conversation here. First of all, about really reaching across the conversational divide that may and most likely already exists any time and blocks any time that you try to bring up these kinds of conversations. This is like one of the best ways I've ever heard so far about breaking down any sort of conversation against climate change skeptics, whether they're religious or non-religious or conservative or Democrat or whatever. Listen to this. This is brilliant. Bill McKibben, founder of 350.org.
Look, for the most part, there's not much arguing with skeptics on climate change at this point because their skepticism isn't rooted in science. It's rooted in ideology. So one tries to say, if, for instance, you're a religious person like myself, I'm a Methodist Sunday school teacher. I try and say, clearly, we're not performing our job as stewards of this earth, and we better get our act together fast. This is interfering with our, you know, the kind of gospel injunction to love one's neighbors. And therefore, it's no surprising that the Pope and the Patriarch of the Orthodox Church and the Dalai Lama and just about any other religious leader you can name has called on us to act. If you're a national security conservative, one can and should point out that this is clearly the great threat to national security and international security going forward. Very clear that as the temperature moves, temperature rises, it's going to put millions, hundreds of millions of people on the move in search of farmland and retreat from rising water, so on and so forth. There's nothing that causes more instability than huge numbers of people on the move. If you're a kind of economic conservative, then the clear answer is this is the greatest case of market failure that we've ever seen. The reason that we make no progress is that markets have no information about carbon. It carries no price. If we can get our political system to put a serious price on it, then we'll begin to find out whether markets work as well as you've always insisted they do. You know, that's one of the few levers we have at this point big enough to pull to make a difference. So the task is always to try and get across to these skeptics that what they're engaged in is not conservative, it's radical. In fact, it's the most radical project any human being's ever embarked on. If you're willing to alter the chemical composition of the atmosphere in order to make money, then you're engaged in something way more radical than anybody in the 1960s ever even thought about. I mean, they were going, Abbie Hoffman managed to scare half of America by saying he was going to put LSD in the water supply of some city someplace. Compared to the CEO of Exxon, he's managing to figure out how to change the chemical composition of the whole freaking atmosphere.
Of the whole freaking atmosphere. You got a Methodist Sunday school teacher to say freaking.
Who put the freak in French fries?
There ain't no freak in French fries.
That's what I've been trying to tell you, butt breath. There ain't no freak in French fries.
Yes. No, I'm sorry. That had nothing to do No, that was completely...
I love that. That old jack-in-the-box bit.
Completely irrelevant.
That's good stuff. Now, but Bill McKibben's spot on, man. I mean, the apocalyptic scenarios are happening faster with greater severity than they, anyone else predicted. And so I think it's, man, it's frightening stuff, man.
I had a cool video I wanted to show you from one of the most recent protests outside of the White House about the Stop the Keystone XL pipeline that was just happening last week, or week before, rather. But I do have a little bit of audio that I want to share with you and some pictures that I am showing on the screen to kind of show you that, look, by the way, there are already folks out there getting active and doing something about it and showing up and participating and making their voice heard and demonstrating. And you see, like, there, this was about the Keystone XL pipeline that, again, we do need to really be pushing on everyone to get active on this and to show up and to participate in the demonstrations, the actual physical demonstrations that are stopping the construction of these pipelines in some places are happening right now. And are we actively participating in those and covering those? And are you hearing about it in anywhere? No, not really. There's a reason, because there's an organized effort to, you know, to do that, to make sure that you don't. But I also want to share this. This is a clip from Sherry Feutland. She was the Gulf of Mexico resident that was at the first Keystone XL pipeline that gave a little speech and was really warning folks about, oh, by the way, you know, it's been a year or 2 years or 3 years since that BP oil disaster happened in the Gulf of Mexico. We're still sick. There's still oil on the beaches. She was that lady, and we played that clip on the show a few times. At this most recent protest last week in D.C., she had this reminder to share with everyone, and I love this.
Thank you very much. Thank you for having me today. Listen, I came here to talk to two different kinds of people. I'd like to talk to all the moms and anyone who has had a mom. Okay? Listen, I live in the Gulf of Mexico. Where I come from, we have a 7-acre sinkhole right now that is growing from drilling for fracking fluid that is pulling in trees and causing distress to the community. We still have BP oil all over our shores. We have children and old people that are sick. We have fishermen with fisheries that are collapsing so that they can't work. One industry does not get to kill another.
Again, that's the Gulf of Mexico resident reminding all the folks at the Keystone XL pipeline in Washington, D.C. about the lasting effects of climate energy disasters that can happen that come from things like pipelines or oil rig drilling units out in, like, the Gulf of Mexico, the BP oil rig disaster. And, I mean, 11 people died in that, and no one at BP was prosecuted, and they got a slap on the wrist, a fine, which means nothing when you make billions of dollars in profit every quarter of the year, and business as usual. Here we go again. Oh, by the way, we need more pipeline, more Keystone XL pipeline, more climate change. No, we don't need it. What we need is you and me to stand up right now and to say something about it, to do something about it, to become active. And whatever facet that may take you, if you're an artist, or if you're a musician, or if you're a radio host, or if you're a website designer, or if you're a, hell, I don't know, whatever you are, you can find outlets and you can participate in the part of the solution here. Remember, we're all part of the solution and we're all part of the problem. It all comes back to which side of that equation are we going to choose to feed more of, right?
Amen, brother.
All right. So let's take a quick break. We'll go a couple minutes early, but that's okay because I want to come back and get through a few awesome Bill McKibben clips from Democracy Now! Thank you, Amy Goodman, democracynow.org, for some brilliant work over there. We'll wrap up the climate change discussion. Scott and I will share our final thoughts, and we'll dive a little bit more back into the Chris Hedges article from today at truthdig.com and all of that and more when we come back Jacob Dean, live in Portland, Oregon, Skeptical Scott in our nation's capital, Washington, D.C., live on filterfreeradio.com, radioornot.com, and progressiveblendradio.com. Don't go anywhere. Scott and I, we will be right back.
Hey, 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 don't you badmouth this country compared to the rest of the third world. We're doing great.
Your number one source for undiluted truth, analysis, and solutions. Filter Free Radio on Radio or Not and FilterFreeRadio.com.
Political Boss Man of the Year, hands down, is Robert Murray, multimillionaire chief of the coal giant Murray Energy. A diehard right-winger and Romney backer, this one percenter required coal miners in his company to be stage props for Romney at an August rally he sponsored, and he also pressured his salaried employees to donate money to the Republicans' run for the White House. Alas, poor Bob did not take Romney's loss at all well, and now he's taking it out on some of those very employees and on the American electorate. First, the workers. The day after the election, Murray announced the firing of more than 160 of them at his various subsidiaries around the country, blaming disastrous policies that he claims Obama will enact in order to bring about the, quote, total destruction of the coal industry by 2030. Peering into his politically warped crystal ball, the corporate soothsayer said he'd be forced to fire more employees in coming months. Why? Bob explained it all in, believe it or not, a post-election prayer that he delivered to staffers at corporate headquarters. Dear Lord, he lamented, the takers outvoted the producers. Guess which group he puts himself in, but I digress. The American people have made their choice away from capitalism, he mourned. We are a country in favor of redistribution, national weakness, and reduced standard of living. Thus pleaded the sanctimonious boss, Lord, please forgive me for the decisions that we are now forced to make. So see, it wasn't Bob who fired those people. It was you, you Obama supporters. Or, as Murray sneeringly called you, the receivers of government giveaways who elected that communistical destroyer of enterprise. This is Jim Hightower saying, Dear Lord, indeed, please save us from the pathetic pieties of such messianic political bosses.
Hightower's commentaries are brought to you by the Hightower Lowdown, the monthly newsletter with Hightower's populist take on what the powers that be are up to. Find out more at HightowerLowdown.org.
This is Stephanie Miller.
Hi, this is Tom Harbin.
Hello, everybody. I'm David Schuster of Take Action News.
I'm Brad Friedman of BradBlog.com.
Hi, I'm cartoonist and agent provocateur P.S. Mueller.
This is Nicole Bell of CrooksandLiars.com, and this is...
You're listening to
and watching
Filter Free Radio.
Filter Free Radio.
Filter Free Radio with Jacob Dean and Skeptical Scott.
Jacob Dean.
With Jacob Dean and Skeptical Scott.
We have socialism for the wealthy and capitalism for the rest of us. I mean, if you're a large multinational bank, and you can borrow money from the Federal Reserve at 0%. I mean, imagine if I can get a college loan at 0% tomorrow. I'd go back to school in a heartbeat, or some sort of a startup loan for a business, and on it goes. These banks are getting trillions at 0%, which is fascinating when you think of things in terms of, wow, this is what these guys are getting. They're getting 0% loans and reinvesting it and making tons of money and then stashing that money offshore and not paying taxes for it. And the money leaves the economy. And it's really the fleecing of America as we know it. It's going to come to fruition at some point here, because it's certainly unsustainable.
Oh, and what we're doing isn't working. Clearly.
FilterFreeRadio.com.
It's the Howdyland.com News Bullet with Stan Douglas. Go to Howdyland.com and click on the Funny Time special offer to receive your free sample issue today.
Right-wing celebrity Sarah Palin was accidentally left on a street corner by her tour crew in Lincoln, Nebraska this morning. In the cold light of day, citizens gathered curiously to stare before moving on with their own lives. Supermarket checker Angie Selko describes the scene.
Well, she's either pushing 50 or dragging it behind her.
And there was sad news from the Morton Salt Company today, which was shuttered by the EPA due to excessive salinity. The company's union salt miners are now believed to be heading for Sugartown. This Howdyland.com news bullet wasn't brought to you by Koch Industries, which is why you're hearing this on the Internet. I'm Stan Douglas.
Hey!
Are you living in a progressive talk void? If so, be sure to visit leftwingradiostations.com. The state-by-state listing is a quick and easy way to find any left-wing talk radio station across America, from sea to shining sea. Your progressive talk nirvana is only a click away at leftwingradiostations.com. Be sure to like Left Wing Radio Stations on Facebook and share it with your friends. leftwingradiostations.com. United we stand.
Hi, friends. This is Tom Hartman.
This is Stephanie Miller.
Hey, this is Hal Sparks.
I'm Brad Friedman. I approve of Nicole Sandler's RadioOrNot.com.
Radio or not.
Radio or not.
Radio or not.com.
Radio or not.com.
Radio or not.com.
Radio or not.com.
Hey, this is Hal Sparks from the Hal Sparks radio program, Mega Worldwide. And you're listening to the Radio or Not evening lineup. Check out Filter Free Radio with Jacob Dean on FilterFreeRadio.com.
This is Filter Free Radio with Jacob Dean and Skeptical Scott.
Filter Free Radio.
Live Monday and Wednesday from 7 to 9 p.m. Eastern.
FilterFreeRadio.com.
Filter Free Radio with Jacob Dean and Skeptical Scott. It's a dirty job, but someone's got to do it. And now, back to Jacob and Scott.
And welcome back to it. Hey, thanks so much for participating live online on our website, filterfreeradio.com. Again, you can visit that. It's 100% free 24/7. But when we are live, click on Watch Live and Chat, and you can participate live in the chat room with all sorts of awesome intellectual contributors. Scott, do you have the chat room open? Let's do a quick shout out to everyone who's in the chat room.
Absolutely. We got Adam. We got myself, of course. Snork Y2K, Taffy Candy, Victor Rocco, and Will from Chicago, and seven guests and the Ustream bot.
Hey, and I'm not in there because my computer sucks. Thanks, Scott, because you're awesome.
Mine's actually running at full capacity, so I'm lucky I haven't crashed yet.
Hey, you and me both here. But hey, that's what nonprofit independent media looks and sounds like. So there you go.
Yeah, shoestring media, baby.
Shoestring media. Let's get back into this article by Chris Hedges over at truthdig.com, which now you can link to directly from our website if you just scroll down a little bit. We've added some new hot links to, of course, like howdyland.com and some other folks, leftwingradiostations.com. You can now hot link to all of those websites on our website. So check that out. But truthdig.com, the article, Chris Hedges today, stand still for the apocalypse, because it's coming. Dun, dun, dun. So, there was a... real quick. There
was it, the whole synopsis of the article, if I could, real quick, is that just sort of his take on the meaning of the World Bank Commission study, that, you know, the dire consequences of a 4 degrees Celsius or 7 and some change degree Fahrenheit increase in the global climate temperature. I mean, it's just it is apocalyptic. I mean, it's unprecedented in the history of the world.
Yes.
So it's all things we should be preparing for and aware of and trying to prevent or at least curtail as much as possible.
Woo! That's what I'm talking about. That takes us to Bill McKibben on Democracy Now!, democracynow.org. This interview happened when Amy Goodman was in Oregon, in Medford, about a few weeks ago, and the night after, I went and met her and got the autograph and everything, and we shared that stuff on our website. It's on the highlights page if you've missed it. But this was also about a day, I think the day before Superstorm Sandy hit the East Coast. And so the conversation was, you know, kind of prefacing this storm hitting. And now, you know, in hindsight, we can look at this conversation slightly differently. But the points that Bill McKibben lays out here is so important. And this is literally the proof that you cannot anyone can deny climate change exists. Because if you do, that predetermined ideology is what's killing you, and it's obviously lost you the presidential election. So here is the first clip from Bill McKibben.
is this is a storm of really historic proportion. It's really like something we haven't seen before. It's huge. It's half again the size of Texas. It's coming across water that's near record warmth as it makes its way up the East Coast. Apparently, we're seeing lower pressures north of Cape Hatteras than have been ever recorded before. The storm surge, which is going to be the very worst part of this storm, is being driven by that huge size and expanse of the storm. But of course, it comes in on water that's already somewhat higher than it would have been in the past because of sea level rise. It's a monster. It's Frankenstorm, frankly, is not only a catchy name, in many ways, it's the right name for it. This thing is stitched together from elements natural and unnatural, and it's seems poised to cause real havoc. The governor of Connecticut said yesterday, the last time we saw anything like this was never. And I think that's about right.
Wake up, people. Some of the numbers, the political and corporate elites in the industrialized world continue in spite of overwhelming scientific data, overwhelming protest organization activism. They continue to place short-term corporate profits before the protection of you and me, human life, literally, and the ecosystem, our home, our planet. The fossil fuel industry is permitted to determine our relationship to the natural world, dooming future generations. Carbon dioxide, the main greenhouse gas, increased from pre-industrial concentration of about 278 parts per million to more than 391 parts per million in September of this year, with the rate of rise now at 1.8 parts per million per year, which means we have long surpassed Bill McKibben's tipping point of 350 parts per million. We're way beyond that level. Life as we know it already cannot be sustained. The question now is, how long, you know, do we continue to kill ourselves before we wake up and say, time to stop the destruction, the self-destruction of the human species, in just in terms of the climate alone, immediately? Right.
I like the quote from the article that says, or the The World Bank Climate Impact Research study that says, quote, "It's useful to recall that a global mean temperature increase of 4 degrees Celsius approaches the difference between temperatures today and those of the last ice age, when much of Central Europe and the northern United States were covered with kilometers of ice and global mean temperatures were about 4.5 to 7 degrees Celsius lower." And this what this means is this magnitude of climate change, human-induced, is occurring over just a century and not a millennia. Wow.
So, and what that's saying is, you know, we think of the ice age, the whole world was frozen over. The point there is that was only a difference of about 4 to 7 degrees Celsius between the ice age, which you think of the earth frozen, and what we comfortably enjoy right now.
And oh, yeah. And it was 7 degrees colder then.
And what they're saying is, in a matter of 100 years from now, we're going to raise the temperature of the planet, that same differential, about 4 to 7 degrees. It's already risen 1 degree so far, and we're trying to stop it from hitting this crucial threshold of 2 degrees Celsius, which would mean we have to basically eliminate all carbon emission, period, from the entire planet in a matter of about 16 years.
So I think the number is 17 years, what they said.
Something like that. But so basically, I guess the point here is, Bill McKibben on Democracy Now!, people wake up and the time to get active is now. If there was ever a time to get active about the human existence on this planet in terms of the climate, it is now.
There has been a pervading climate silence. We're doing our best to break that. There was a demonstration in Times Square, a sort of giant dot to connect the dots with all the other climate trouble around the world. Overnight, continuing in Boston, there's a week-long vigil outside Government Center to try and get Senate candidates there to address the issue of climate change. It's incredibly important that we not only, I mean, first priority is obviously people's safety, and assisting relief efforts in every possible way. But it's also really important that everybody, even those who aren't in the kind of path of this storm, reflect about what it means that in the warmest year in U.S. history, when we've seen the warmest month, July, of any month, any year in U.S. history, in a year when we saw essentially summer sea ice in the Arctic just vanish before our eyes, what it means that we're now seeing storms of this unprecedented magnitude. If there was ever a wake-up call, this is it.
Family and friends and folks here in Portland on the West Coast with me. Sandy hit the East Coast. Didn't matter. I don't care. We're fine. Everything's great here. We often neglect to mention that just this year alone, we had the wettest spring on record, most rainfall, and you think of Portland, a lot of rain, right? The wettest spring on record ever, followed by the driest summer going back to like 1870 on record. The second driest summer in history, back to back, wettest spring, driest summer. It's not that, oh, global warming or climate change means that everything's just going to cook us to death. No, it means it's like global weirding or more extremes of the weather patterns that already exist. We're going to get hurricanes and tornadoes. They're going to be more extreme. We're going to get sun and heat in the summertime, it's going to be more extreme. We're going to get wet snowfall in the winter. It's going to be more extreme, right? And
not to mention things like hurricanes and you know, earthquakes and lions and tigers and bears. Oh my! and all the it's just there's so many secondary. You know, when all the large fishes in the ocean go extinct, I mean, there's whole civilizations that rely on fishing. That those civilizations will certainly die off or have to migrate. Or we get things like what Snork pointed out to me the other day was that these giant sinkholes are happening in Queens after Hurricane Sandy. You know, and there's sinkholes going on. You know, there's just so many things that you don't think of. Like, no one expects a sinkhole in their backyard, right?
Right.
You know, or their house to just be absorbed by the earth. Like, a sinkhole open up and just swallow you up. I mean, there's just, it really is apocalyptic. And we need to start doing things to avert it. And we need to start doing things to prepare for some of the catastrophes that are already going to be unavoidable at this point, you know, because we're not going to. I mean, it's hopeful, I think, and realistic on some respects to think we can get off, you know, carbon altogether in 17 years. I don't think that's unrealistic. I think it's unlikely. But, you know, we may, you know, put a man on the moon in, what, 10 years or whatever it was. You know, it's like, which at that point seemed just unfathomable to people. Mm-hmm. So there's possibilities out there, but people have to really wake up and really demand these things. Otherwise, we're going to let the fossil fuel industry dictate, well, the downfall of our civilization as we know it.
You know, I obviously wasn't around during, you know, the race to the moon, but I, from what I know in history and stuff, it was really framed in, you know, which country was going to race to the moon first, right? Well, why don't we frame a conversation around the race of our generation today is which country is going to be the first to solve and implement the actual solutions, like, don't just talk the talk, but actually walk the walk to solve climate change. It's a race to save the future.
Yeah, who will establish a sustainable culture, a sustainable society, one that's, you know, in harmony with nature?
Well, I'm sorry to cut you off, Scott, but then that brings about another question of are we going to do it willingly? But that's a whole nother discussion, right?
No, I'm with you on that one. Oh, for some, it won't be willingly. I mean, right. That's the whole point of agitating and advocating and forcing the issue on people, you know, like Dow Chemical and Coke Industries and ExxonMobil and plastics manufacturers and all these things. You know, it's you really have to create a culture where people are willing to stop doing the things that are causing, or at least stop contributing to the cause well, the death of the planet and the death of our species. And so I think, you know, it starts locally, it starts individually, and then and gradually builds into a mass movement. And the hope, I think, at this point is that we can galvanize a global resistance movement to such a thing in the next 15 years. It sounds almost impossible, but
well, and that leads me to the next clip that Amy Goodman of democracynow.org asks Bill McKibben here, kind of the setup, the kind of skeptic question of, well, do you actually think what you're doing is working? And I love Bill McKibben, founder of 350.org's response here. Really, no matter what the outcome of our resistance and dissent and our activism will be, no matter what the outcome actually is, it doesn't matter because we still have to fight, because now is the time to get active or else it will be too late.
Bill McKibben, what do you think has to happen now? You have been traveling the world warning people, working with organizations around the issue of climate change. Do you feel like the kind of organizing you're doing has an effect? I mean, you see these three presidential debates, tens of millions of people watch them. They sort of define the discourse in this country, and yet not raised in any. It's not only the candidates don't raise them. The reporters who are the moderators of these debates don't raise them.
Look, we're up against the most powerful and richest industry on Earth, and the status quo is their friend. They want nothing to change. And until we're able to force them to the table, as it were, very little will happen in Washington or elsewhere. That's why we launched this huge tour beginning the night after the election, not coincidentally, in Seattle and continuing around the country. You can find out about it at math.350.org. But the point is that we really finally need to have this reckoning. Either the fossil fuel industry keeps pouring carbon into the atmosphere and we keep seeing this kind of event, or we take some action.
Which one are we going to choose? Which one are we going to choose? I like that clip of, actually, I wonder if I can pull it up real quick, of Noam Chomsky that basically says there really is no choice. Actually, do I have it? Yes, I think I do have it.
To a pretty good first approximation, that's the way in which the general public relations system, advertising industry. And
nope, that's the wrong clip. Sorry, that wasn't it. My bad. Thought that was it. That
wasn't right. It. Still Noam Chomsky. I love Noam Chomsky.
But the point was is that there is no choice. It's like you think there's a choice. No, that's actually, that's not.
Oh, yeah, the clip where he says, you know, given the choice of doing nothing, which will certainly ensure our destruction, and then doing something to at least attempt to prevent our destruction, there is no choice.
Maybe this, you know, is
it's
it.
It's survival.
So a lot of success. But I think the basic reason is just very simple. You have two choices. You can say, look, everything's hopeless, so I'm not going to do anything, and help guarantee that the worst will happen. Or you can say, well, things are tough, but they've been worse before, and if we get engaged, maybe we can carry things forward. Between those two choices, there's no real choice.
Yeah, there is no choice.
It seems so straightforward, and yet we have a society that's is just utterly clamoring for its own demise. You know, at this point, they don't know any better. And the goal, I think, for most people is to, you know, is to have more things, more stuff. It's the consumerism mentality, and in doing so, you really just you foster your own enslavement and your own demise. Because I can't tell you the people I've encountered who just want things, and these things really are just so heavily weighted on the environment. It starts with internal combustion engines and things of that nature, and things that require large manufacturing capacities, and you know, and red meat, and there's the list is long of what we consider luxury items that are just so heavily destructive to the environment. And we're not even talking about the military. I mean, the military is the largest producer of carbon dioxide as far as one, you know, industry is concerned on the planet. They burn more fossil fuels than anybody else in the United States. So, I mean, even though they're all over the world at this point, you know, so let's start there. Let's stop killing people in foreign parts of the world that we don't know or and have, you know, at least on a personal basis, no grief with, and start investing in infrastructure and sustainability and be a beacon of hope for the world rather than a terrorist.
And you're so right. And that's the next clip here from Bill McKibben. It's time to. So what do you do? How do we get active? Okay, I want to get active. Okay, I get it. Okay, planet's going to die. We're going to die. We got to get active. Okay, I got it. Okay, what do? We have to take on the fossil fuel and I was trying to do a Jon Stewart thing, but it didn't work
out. That was a bit of a, yeah, that was almost a little bit of a Goodfellas accent. I love that.
So what do we do? Well, it's time to directly take on the fossil fuel industry. They are the biggest contributor to the part of the problem and the least contributor to the part of the solution.
Here's the thing always to remember. The crazy changes that we're seeing now, the fact that we broke the Arctic this summer, the fact that the oceans are 30% more acid, that's all happened when you raised the temperature of the Earth 1 degree. The same scientists who told us that was going to happen are confident that the temperature will go up 4 degrees, maybe 5, unless we get off coal and gas and oil very quickly. And to do that, you know, it's nice to talk to Washington, but in certain ways, Washington's turned into customer service for the fossil fuel industry. It's time to take on that industry directly.
Burned. Oh, I wanted to hear something like that. That was great.
Amen, Bill McKibben. Yeah. I love the notion, and it's on a much larger scale, and it applies to everything from the economy to you name it. And that is addressing who really has the power. Power is not in Washington to stop the fossil fuel industry. We have to stop the fossil fuel industry, and then Washington will follow suit. And yep. That's how that works.
Yep. And keep in mind here, again, to kind of bring back that 20-second clip that we played of Noam Chomsky, if we do nothing, we will lose by default anyways. So there is no choice. Should I get active or should I be participating? You actually don't really have a choice. That's the point here. And if you fail to get active, if you fail to respond, Chris Hedges sums up his article on Truthdig with this message: a failure to respond will assure an ecological nightmare that will most probably be accompanied by an economic, social, and political breakdown. The human species, the report says, going back to it, will cross, quote, critical social system thresholds. That's an awesome catchphrase to start, like, memorizing. Critical social system thresholds. That's a good vocal warm-up. Critical social system thresholds.
No, syphilis.
And continuing, quote, existing institutions that... There we go. Excuse me. Went down there for a second. Existing institutions that would have supported adaptation actions would likely become much less effective or even collapse. And the stress on human health, you and me, our health, the stresses like heat waves and malnutrition and decreasing quality of drinking water due to seawater intrusions and these other things have the potential to really overburden our already overburdened healthcare systems to a point where adaptation really is no longer possible and dislocation is forced, meaning it's going to get so bad that we're just going to have to, like, kind of pick up and move to a new thing and try to start over kind of thing. Really? Well, if that is even possible is the point here. That's why we're screwed. So to finish up to kind of quote this article to wrap up here, quoting from the article, there is also no certainty that an adaptation to a 4 degrees Celsius or less than world is possible. It goes on, a 4 degrees world is likely to be one in which communities, cities, countries would experience severe disruptions, damage, dislocation, and many of these risks will spread unequally. It will likely be that the poor will suffer the most and global community could become more fractured and unequal than today. The inequality that is existing already, the inequality that is existing today, that's already sparking movements globally, could increase. And we've talked about on this program many times, what happens when that threshold of like reality and expectations grows too wide? What happens when that inequality gap grows too wide, when the haves have too much and the have-nots have not enough, to the point of extreme? What happens? That's why Chris Hedges' article is called "We're to the effect of stand still for the apocalypse. The apocalypse may happen unless we get active. Are you going to just stand still and not do a damn thing about it? Or are you going to get active and get out there and show up and do something about it? Starting by, alternative transportations. If we're going to limit all carbon emissions in 15 years. Don't, granted, 15 years is a long time. If we start the conversation now and get the ball rolling and get the conversation going now, and propagate the conversation, propagate the talking points, understand that no one can no longer deny these kinds of things. The science is there. The climate change is there. Talk to our friends and brothers and sisters and family on the East Coast who still are out of homes, who still don't have electricity or power thanks to Super Frankenstorm Sandy. We didn't really get to dive into how the clips of how the climate change can really tie into the Sandy storm could really tie into being an example of climate change, just because we haven't seen.
You have more clips for that?
Well, I just don't have time. But on this episode, maybe we'll cover it on Wednesday. But, just the kind of final point here, again, is one of our favorite points, really, is let's be more part of the solution than we are part of the problem. And right now, that means you and I need to get active in the streets, participating in whatever sorts of organized and thought out and well effective things that we can do, and actually target, the fossil fuel industry. How can we shame them into a submission, really? Get a carbon tax going. Whatever it needs to be, it needs to start happening now. And it starts with you and I starting the conversation. Scott, your final thoughts, man, before we rock and roll here?
Amen, brother. Good on you for getting out there and getting that footage of Walmart and all the good stuff you got here with Bill McKibben. I appreciate it, man. It's good work. But I think just to sum up everything, there's just a litany of things to be done, and it all starts on the individual basis, and asking, well, what we can do. I know personally, like I started going to the local farmers market and doing my best to shop locally, including, unfortunately it's more expensive, man, which is what's really getting me. But by the same token, it really is, there are things individuals can do to sort of curtail or at least start doing what is the right thing, I guess, or sustainable thing, if you will, for the environment and for yourself. Because as we've all learned and we all know at this point, things are going to get worse before they get better. And that's assuming that we're going to do something to make it get better. And so I'm just always reminded of the imagery of the last days of Pompeii, where people were, before the volcano erupted, where people were just going about their daily business, and then they were just frozen in time of what they were doing when the catastrophe happened. Because I think that's kind of where we are as a society, although it'll probably be a lot slower and a lot more painful.
On that note, Scott gets the final word on this episode of Filter Free Radio. Thank you so much for hanging out with us. I want to thank everyone who helps make this program possible, starting with my super duper awesome mass producer, co-host, Skeptical Scott, live in Washington, D.C. Thank you, brother, from another mother. Want to thank Nicole Sandler, RadioOrNot.com, and DJ Downtown of The More Me Show at ProgressiveBlendRadio.com for syndicating this program. All the awesome folks in the chat room, for you for checking out our website and all the free video and audio archives at FilterFreeRadio.com, spreading the word. Remember the 555 plan, tell five friends, because that's how grassroots activism from the bottom up really propagates and gets things done. Get out there, get active. We'll see you on Wednesday. Have a good one, everyone.
Filter Free Radio.
There's a time when the operation of the machine becomes so odious, makes you so sick at heart, that you can't take part. You can't even passively take part. And you've got to put your bodies upon the gears and upon the wheels, upon the levers, upon all the apparatus, and you've got to make it stop.
So give me something to believe. 'Cause I am living just to breathe. And I need something more to keep on breathing for. So give me something to believe.
The revolution will be broadcast.
Monday and Wednesday from 7 to 9 p.m. Eastern. Filter Free Radio.